Hey everyone, welcome back to another video here on DarkSec. I am Dark, and today we're going to be taking a look at the How Websites Work room on TryHackMe. To exploit a website, you first need to know how they are created. Task 1, How Websites Work. By the end of this room, you'll know how websites are created and will be introduced to some of the basic security issues. When you visit a website, your browser, like Safari or Google Chrome, makes a request to a web server asking for information about the page you're visiting and will respond with data that your browser uses to show you the page. A web server is just a dedicated computer somewhere else in the world that handles your requests. So you can see here that we just have a basic diagram of how this connection actually works. So for example, when you go to tryhackme.com, your browser sends a request for tryhackme.com over the internet to some server that's living off in Cloudland. That receives that request and sends back a response with that actual data that is the website, which is what we can see here. There are two major components that make up a website. First, we have the front end, which is the actual what we see from the client side of things. This is the way that your browser renders a website. Then we have the back end. These are more traditionally development terms. You'll see this on people's resumes that they are they might be a full stack developer, which the actual developers in watching this video will probably be laughing at, since full stack is very, very difficult because you're doing both styling of the website and you're actually doing the technical back end too. The back end is the server that really processes your request and returns a response. Think data processing here, think the actual visuals here. Both of them are very difficult in their own rights, but they are very different skills because you have design aspects on one side from more of like a client and usability approach. And then on the back end, you have more of that actual, the processing, how the servers fit together, how that server side technology works as well. There are many other processes involved in your browser making a request to a web server. But for now, you just need to understand that you need to make a request to a server and it responds with data your browser uses to render information to you. What term describes the way your browser renders a website? That is going to be technically front end, I think, in the way that this room wants it. Yeah. So front end is, again, client side things, if that makes sense. So let's move into task 2, HTML. Websites are primarily created using HTML to build websites and define their structure, CSS to make websites look pretty by adding styling options, and then JavaScript, which is used to implement complex features on pages using interactivity. HTML, otherwise known as hypertext markup language, is the language websites are written in. Elements, also known as tags, are the building blocks of HTML pages and tell the web browser how to display the content. The code below shows a simple HTML document, the structure of which is the same for every website. So here we can see just the basic, this is the very bare bones of what you need for a web page. You can see the doc type is declared up here as HTML. Then we have the actual HTML opening and closing tags. And then we have a couple other goodies in between. And we'll walk through that here in just a moment. The HTML structure, as shown in the screenshot, has the following components. So first we have the doc type HTML that defines that the page is an HTML5 document. That does matter for the version, for what is going to be supported for the features. Older versions won't have as many features, and they'll have features that may be deprecated in newer versions and newer modern web browsers. They will look at this and they'll just ignore things, or they'll actually make things work because of that. This helps with standardization across different browsers and tells the browser to use HTML5 to interpret the page. The HTML element is the root element of the HTML page. All other elements come after this element. So think of it as kind of like a sandwich. You have your top and bottom bun, and in this case, those are HTML tags. Next, we have the head element, which contains information about the page, such as the page title. So this is just a section. You have your head, which is going to be your title. There's a couple other things that can go in here, but we won't mention those for now, just to keep things simple. And then we have the actual body, which we'll get into in just a moment. The body element defines the HTML document's body. Only content inside of the body is shown in the browser. So the actual meat and potatoes that you're seeing here is going to show up here. So for example, we saw the title up here. That's what appears up here in this case in the actual tab. And the body is what appears on the page. The H1 element defines a large heading, so heading and then size 1 for that. The P element defines a paragraph. There are many other elements or tags used for different purposes. For example, there are tags for buttons, which is just the button tag, images, shortened to IMG, lists, and much more. Tags can contain attributes such as the class attribute, which can be used to style an element. So think of this as a way that we can attach kind of a description or sort of like a defining tag to it. We can use this to address it, which is much more useful when we actually get into doing CSS. As we have many things that are kind of the same thing, so think many pictures on a website, and we want them all to be, they're all next to each other, and we want them all to be sized the same way, we can do that with using these class attributes, and then we can address them accordingly from CSS. So here we have an example, the paragraph that has this class as bold text, or the source attribute, which is used on images to specify the location of an image. And here we can see that here. We can actually see where that is in action, and in this case, we're saying that we're going to the image folder in the web root directory and then into that to grab the cat.jpg picture. An element can have multiple attributes, each with its own unique purpose. So for example, we can have attribute 1 equals value 1, attribute 2 equals value 2, and so on and so forth. Elements can also have an ID attribute. So for example, paragraph and then ID equals example, which is unique to the element. And again, this is a way that you can class things that if you want a very specific thing to be addressed, you can do it this way. Very helpful if you want to have sort of maybe a unique part of the web page that you want to style very distinctively and want to make sure you're addressing the correct thing. Unlike the class attribute, where multiple elements can use the same class, an element must have different IDs to uniquely identify them. Element IDs are used for styling and to identify it by JavaScript. You can view the HTML of any website by right-clicking and selecting View Page Source in Chrome or Show Page Source in Safari. It's the same thing as Chrome as it is in Firefox, where you can just right-click. Let's play with some HTML. On the right-hand side, you should see a box that renders HTML. If you enter some HTML into the box and click the green Render HTML button up here, it will render your HTML on the page, and you should see an image of some cats in this case. So we can go ahead and click on that. And if we scroll down, there we go. We can see the rendered HTML code. Very cool. One of the images on the website is broken. Fix it, and the image will reveal a hidden text answer. So it looks like it is just missing its JPEG tag, which we can add back in pretty quickly, and we get the code HTML hero. Very cool. Add a dog image to the page by adding another image tag on line 11. The dog image is location is image /dog-1png, and we can do that here. Maybe img src equals img /dog-1.png, and then we'll end the parentheses, and there we go. We can see that we've added our dog, and I'm fairly certain that is Ollie. If you are not aware who Ollie is, you should join the Discord. It is wonderful, the TryHackMe Discord specifically. And there we go. That's going to do it for task 2. Let's move into task 3 and start learning about some JavaScript. JavaScript, often shortened to just JS, is one of the most popular coding languages in the world and allows pages to become interactive. HTML is used to create the website structure and content, while JavaScript is used to control the functionality of websites. Without JavaScript, a page would not have interactive elements and would always be static. JavaScript can dynamically update the page in real time, giving functionality to change the style of a button when a particular event on a page occurs, such as when a user clicks a button, or to display moving animations. So JavaScript is what really adds the magic here. JavaScript is added within the page source code and can either be loaded within script tags or can be included remotely with the source attribute. So here we can see the source here, where we're loading JavaScript files in remotely from within the web server. The following JavaScript code finds an HTML element on the page with the ID of demo and changes the element's context or contents to hack the planet. So here we can see document. So we're addressing the actual web page here. Get element by ID. Again, remember we talked about IDs up above, and we're looking for the ID named demo. And then inside of that, we're going to change that to hack the planet. HTML elements can also have events such as onClick or onHover that execute JavaScript when the event occurs. Think pop-up ads where or pop-ups on the page where you hover over something and something appears or something happens. That's exactly how this works. The following code changes the text of the element with the demo ID to button clicked. So here we can do, we have a button here that says onClick, the document.getID demo. So when we're clicking this, we're changing the demo ID to be button clicked. And the button inside of it has the text click me. OnClick events can also be identified or defined inside the JavaScript script tags and not on elements directly. Click on the view site button on this task on the right hand side, add JavaScript that changes the demo elements content to hack the planet. So we can do that here. And let's see, so we want to add the JavaScript here, and we can grab that actually just right over here on the left hand side, document.getElementById, and then we want what's inside of the demo element, inner HTML, and then we'll set that equal to hack the planet. And there we go. And because it's JavaScript, I do believe that we need to have that semicolon at the end of the line. Let's see. Let's try that now. Maybe. Let's check our hint. Strange. Here, I'm going to pause this for just a moment. I am not sure why it's just being fussy. All right. Make sure that you have capitalization correct. So my B here was not capitalized and the D was. And you do need to make sure that you have the semicolon. So if we click render HTML plus JS code, we can get a pop-up that says, congratulations, the answer to the question is JS is fun in all caps. And there we go. We can click submit. Add the button HTML from this task that changes the element's text to button clicked on the editor on the right, update the code by clicking render HTML plus JS code button, and then click the button. So we can just copy this in. I'm not going to be clever and try to put this in myself. And we will just put this right here. And that should be fine. There we go. So we can see that it changes it to button clicked down here. So we can mark that as completed and move into task 4, sensitive data exposure. Sensitive data exposure is when a website doesn't properly protect or remove sensitive clear text information to the end user, usually found in the front-end source of sites. We now know that websites are built using many HTML elements, tags, as all of which we can see simply by clicking view page source. A website developer may have forgotten to remove login credentials, hidden links to private parts of the website, or other sensitive data shown in HTML or JavaScript. Sensitive information can be potentially leveraged to further an attacker's access within different parts of a web application. For example, there could be HTML comments with temporary login credentials, and if you viewed the page's source code and found this, you could use these credentials to log in elsewhere on the application, or worse, used to access other backend components of the website. This happens. This happens a lot. A lot of issues that are encountered just within penetration testing or bug bounty hunting are just very simple things like this that happen. Things get missed when they're pushed to prod all the time. Whenever you're accessing a web page or web application for security issues or assessing, rather, one of the first things you should do is review the page source code to see if you can find any exposed login credentials or hidden links. View the website on this task. Where is what is the password hidden in the source code? So we can go over here. And if we click view page source, this should come up over here, maybe. Here. Let's see what we got. I don't know if it's going to come up over here. We'll give it just a moment. I'm going to go ahead and pause this and hunt for it. All right, we're back. I might be missing a button here, but entering in incorrect credentials gave me this option to look at the source code, which we can see pops up just over here. I'll make this a little bit bigger. And we can see that it looks like we have some credentials just commented out here. So we have the username of admin and then test password. So test passwd, we'll submit that. And maybe, there we go. Let's try logging in with that. See if it does anything. Okay, congratulations. Thank you, TryAcme, for that. Congratulations. Let's move into task 5, HTML injection. HTML injection is a vulnerability that occurs when an unfiltered user input is displayed on the page. If a website fails to sanitize user input, i.e. filter any malicious text that a user inputs into a website, and that input is used on the page, an attacker can inject HTML code into a vulnerable website. Input sanitization is very important in keeping a website secure, as information a user inputs into a website is often used in other front-end and back-end functionality. A vulnerability you'll explore in another lab is database injection, where you can manipulate a database lookup query to log in as another user by controlling the input that's directly used in the query. Think of it this way, if we can input our own code into a website, no matter what that code is, if it is SQL, database queries, that is, and it is interacting with a database on the back end in somehow that our code is legitimate, or we can put HTML code or JavaScript, we can make bad things happen with that. But for now, we're gonna go ahead and focus on that HTML injection, which this is just client side because it's displayed back to the user. When a user has control of how their input is displayed, they can submit HTML or JavaScript code and the browser will use it on the page, allowing the user to control the page's appearance and functionality. So here we can see that we're typing in our name, and it looks like it's getting it by that ID there, and it's sending back a welcome message with that welcome plus name. Now, we can end that and just throw our own HTML code in there because it's not sanitized. The image above shows how a form outputs text to the page. Whatever the user inputs into the what is your name field is passed to a JavaScript function and output to the page, which means that if a user adds their own HTML or JavaScript in the field, it's used in the say hi function and is added to the page. This means that you can add your own HTML, such as an H1 tag, and it will output your input as pure HTML. The general rule is never to trust user input. To prevent malicious input, the web developer should sanitize everything that the user enters before or using it in the JavaScript function. In this case, the developer could remove any HTML tags. Whenever you are allowing users to do anything, you need to be very careful around that because users are your big untrusted space, so you need to act accordingly. Let's go ahead and view the site that we're going to be attacking. View the website on this task and inject HTML code so that a malicious link to httphacker.com is shown. So we'll do test. And we are going to do, we might need a link tag for this. Let's go ahead and just do httphacker.com and then see what we get. Okay. So we will need a link tag on this. Let's see if it's going to give us a hint. Google how to create an HTML link. Okay. I will be right back. I haven't done web dev in a while. All right, we're back. I looked it up on W3 Schools because I have shame. Let me go ahead and grab that. We're going to put that here. So it is just going to be an A tag. This should work. We're going to change our text to hacked. And there we go. So again, I went and grabbed an A tag just off of W3 schools, and then you can just put the actual link that you want in this href field, and then the text can be whatever you want. In my case, it just ended up being hacked. Congratulations, the answer is HTML_injection with, it looks like, a 3 and an O. We'll see if we can copy that out. Let's see, maybe not. Okay, there we go. We'll go and submit that. And that is going to do it for this room and this video. If you have any questions, as always, I will have the TryHackMe Discord linked in the description below. Otherwise, until next time, happy hacking!